Welcome back. This is episode 231 of the Veterinary Business Video Show. In this episode, we'll learn something about fear-free veterinary practice owners, and we'll enjoy an extract from Les Miserables with a veterinary flavour. We'll hear why we should all write a failure resume. We'll learn why we shouldn't use wiggle words when we talk to clients, and I'll offer you my quick business tip for this episode. I'm John Sheridan, and this is the video show from Veterinary Business. Many years ago, I was privileged to share a session with Marty Becker at the Management Symposium here in the UK. And since then, I've enjoyed meeting up with him on several occasions. Marty was the founder of the Fear-Free Philosophy, which has become one of the most transformative initiatives in the history of pet animal practice, with nearly 33,000 veterinary and other healthcare professionals becoming fear-free certified. Here's a clip about fear-free featuring Joel Parker, but this time the concern isn't about maintaining fear-free pets, but fear-free veterinary practice owners.
This week I'm going to be talking to you guys about fear-free practice ownership, and is this possible? Many of you, like myself, initially jumped into practice ownership because it didn't look all that hard. You know, hey, you know, we worked for somebody else, payday was every 2 weeks, you got along with all the staff, et cetera, et cetera, and then you bought a practice. And overnight, all that changed. All of a sudden, the staff that you were working with didn't talk to you anymore, you were all of a sudden the boss, et cetera, et cetera, and you realize that, hey, maybe this wasn't such a smart thing to do in the end. I've been through that, and the analogy, as you know, that I love using is buying an aircraft, you know, without going to flight school. You know, many of us have watched enough television, we know about, the throttle balls against the wall for full takeoff, but how many of us actually would go and buy an aircraft without going to flight school? You know, and I think that all of us, you know, watching this have watched enough television that we know that, you know, you got to put the balls against the wall and then pull up on the steering wheel and the plane eventually rises. But, you know, is that a sane way to run a practice? And the answer is no. If you want to freak yourself out, if you want to be, you know, living in the fear bands, then buy a practice and don't get trained in how to run it, okay? Because it's like anything, whether you're riding a bike or climbing a mountain or, you know, driving a car for the first time, there's a certain amount of fear and trepidation that goes with it, and that's normal. That's a normal protective reflex. Where fear gets in the way is if there's opportunities in front of you and you miss out on those opportunities because the fear is causing you to hold back. So what we want is fear-free practice ownership through good training, okay? And you'll find with training, like anything, whether that's climbing a mountain or riding a bicycle for the first time, with training and practice, you become more relaxed and you begin to have fun, which practice ownership can be and is for many of us. Okay, guys, so a couple action steps here for you this week. Always, always, always manage off of data. Okay, you know, you're trained as veterinarians and managers, you're trained, many of you as technicians. We manage typically cases off of data. We can do the same with practice. So if you want to manage your practice off new clients, then start tracking the number of new clients coming into the practice. Track the weekly gross income and graph it out. Share that with your staff, okay? Play it like a sports team. We manage sports teams off of data. Same thing goes with your practice. I want you guys to think big, okay? All too easy do we get trapped down into the minutiae of running the practice and the technician that shows up late, or the grumpy client, or the receptionist that said something to a client that was incorrect. We get trapped down into that minutia. But you've got to understand, as a practice owner, one of the most key, one of the most vital, important actions you do is to think big. You know, be over there in what we call the vision division, where you've got your vision. You're thinking big. How many practices do you want to own? How big do you want to be? You've got to spend some time there and get out of that normal day-to-day trenches where all the minutiae is. And then finally, guys, get yourself trained like I did. I went and found an incredible MBA style program, like what they call an executive MBA style program, where I would leave the practice for about a week every couple months, go get trained, get refreshed, go to another city, and then I'd come back and I'd work with my consultant. And over time, in this highly, highly competitive environment, my practice started to grow by 15 to 20%. It didn't naturally do that. It did that because I studied marketing, I studied HR and hiring the right people, I studied how to train people and correct them, I studied finances, like how to make, you know, how to make sure that the bank account was rising. So guys, I took responsibility for my actions. I quit winging it, you know, on flying the plane by without any training. I went back to flight school for veterinary practices. I got trained and had a big win on it in the end. That's what I want for you guys. Again, VPS here, we're championing the private practice owners. You guys out there that are putting yourselves on the lines and owning practices. It's not always easy, but it's fun if you know what you're doing.
Now let's see who's on the video show, Soapbox. In this episode, soapbox or series of soapboxes are occupied by the second year students at the Virginia Maryland College of Veterinary Medicine. Michael Napier, instructor at the Ovario Hysterectomy Lab, imagined a fun final project that would foster teamwork and send a message to his students. It's a parody from Les Miserables and it's called, wait for it, One Spay More.
One spay more, another spay remove the ovaries, this ever-stressful road of surgeries. A dirty scrub to clear the grime, a sterile scrub the second time, one spay more.
No, it's wise to sterilize, and to make sure these drugs get charted.
One spay more.
Not getting sleep was so unwise. I want my bed, but we've just started. One more spay, but why this cat? You will never breed again. One more spay until this course ends.
We can't wait until it's through.
Got my spay pack already.
Want one odd suture or two?
Will my scalpel blade with care?
One more spay beneath the gaze.
Look at this pup's little nose.
We will meet at 10 to 7.
Shall I see my teammates there?
And make sure the suture stays.
Might be late, but we'll be there.
To graduation, fortitude, hang in there, bud. We've been prepping you, dear students. 9 for taste of wit of blood.
Watch your wing in up.
Glad it's pretty full. Then out here 20 minutes, but there's still no stool.
Here's a little snip.
There's a little cut.
They never use the donut, so they won't miss much.
One step to a new beginning.
Ask us if you try.
Chance to cut, a chance to cure.
Teach them what we
do. This is
good. It's freaking cool. It's now 40 minutes and there's still no stool.
Tomorrow is a hustle day. Tomorrow is our lecture day.
Tomorrow we'll discover what our vet med teachers had in store. One more yawn. One more say.
Could a UK vet school do better? Of course it could. Now for a tip from the top in the business world of veterinary practice. I was talking recently to a colleague about franchising veterinary practice. Joint venture veterinary practice partnerships are quite common now in the UK, and in many ways the joint venture model is very similar to a business format franchise. Back in the late 1970s and early 80s, I built a small chain of franchised practices, But my model foundered, and one of these days I should perhaps write an article, How Not to Franchise Veterinary Practice. That was just one of my many failures, large and small, during my career, so I was interested to come across this clip in which Dan Pink hears why we should all write a failure resume.
Hi everyone, welcome to another Pinkcast. I'm here at Stanford University School of Engineering with Professor of Practice Tina Seelig. You know Tina from her books, What I Wish I Knew When I Was 20, Inside Out, and other fine titles. She is here to share with you, Pinkcast viewers, a piece of advice. Tina.
Well, my biggest advice for you in 1 minute is to keep a failure resume.
Hmm.
Now, what is that?
Yes, what is a failure resume?
It's a list.
I have a feeling mine will be quite long.
Well, mine is really long. In fact, I add to it every day. Essentially, okay. It's a list of all your biggest screw-ups, personal, professional, and academic.
Oh, my.
And the idea is you can't just write down what you did. You have to write down what you learned from it.
Oh.
And essentially, this becomes a document of everything you learn every single day. And it's much more likely that you will not repeat the same mistakes if you actually write them down, acknowledge them, and write down what you've learned from them.
So do you keep a file on your computer? Is that how it works?
Well, sometimes it's in my head, but sometimes I write it down, and I actually require my students to do this.
Interesting.
Yeah, we do classes on risk-taking and failure, and I teach the students that failure is just data.
Yeah,
but you need
sure,
to mine
that's true.
It.
Right.
You need to mine it so
right.
that you actually learn something.
Right, right. And without the mining, it's useless. It's just regret in some ways.
Exactly.
So do you share your failure resume with other people, or is it something that's really for you?
Good question. In fact, in my book, What I Wish I Knew When I Was 20, I actually put my own failure resume. One of the young students who read an early version of the book said, I love this concept. I'd like to see an example. And I said, well, whose example am I going to put in? So I ended up writing my own and putting in the book.
That is such great advice, Pinkcast viewers. So go out there right now and start a failure resume. Thanks to Tina Seelig.
Goes on your failure
That's my
resume.
Failure resume. I've just added to my failure resume with this Pinkcast. Thanks for watching.
Now for my quick business tip for this episode. An American Animal Hospital Association study found that only 38% of clients accept treatment when pets are diagnosed with dental disease. They discovered that in most cases poor compliance was not about cost, but because the practice team had failed to convey the importance or the value of treatment. Here's a clip in which Wendy Myers offers some advice.
An American Animal Hospital Association study found only 38% of clients accept treatments when their pets are diagnosed with dental disease. Compliance was not about cost. Teams actually failed to convey the importance or value of treatment. To overcome clients' fear of anesthesia, use the right words. Avoid wiggle words, such as, I recommend that your dog gets a pre-anesthetic test. Pet owners hear that blood work and urinalysis is just a suggestion and is not medically necessary. Be a patient advocate and communicate the importance of diagnostics. Replace the wiggle word of recommend with a stronger word of need. Your pet needs a pre-anesthetic screen to ensure he's in good health. Diagnostics are an internal physical exam that's going to check the function of his organs and identify any unknown diseases. Avoid medical jargon, which may confuse pet owners. Don't say we're going to hook your dog up to a pulse oximeter and electrocardiogram. That sounds expensive and scary. Instead, share the outcomes of electronic monitoring. We will monitor your pet's heart rate, level of oxygen in the blood, and body temperature during surgery. Your ability to use the right words and to confidently answer questions about your anesthetic protocols will sway clients' decisions.
So what's my quick business tip? Well, it's this. I recorded a video blog recently entitled Beware the Impact of the Words You Use. So I'm acutely aware of the importance of choosing the right words, or perhaps not choosing the wrong words, in our conversations with clients and colleagues in practice. So my quick business tip today is take another look at Wendy's clip and make sure that your practice team first avoid medical jargon, and second, don't use wiggle words like recommend when they talk to clients about the need for anesthesia. Well, that's about it for now. I'm John Sheridan, and this has been another video show from Veterinary Business. See you next time.